Alfred Nordmann, thank you very much for taking the time for this interview. You have done substantial work on anticipation, and anticipation is part of responsible research and innovation. In one of your papers, Responsible Innovation, the Art and Craft of Anticipation, you focused on this. What are the main challenges of anticipating impacts in general and anticipating impacts on innovation in particular?
Well, the main challenge is to see what we expect from anticipation. If we look at examples of how we anticipate things, we might think of, let's say, the goalkeeper in soccer who can anticipate where a ball is coming from. Or we might think of a driver on the road, and if a ball runs across the street, you know that a child might be running behind it. I mean, these are forms of anticipation. But these forms of anticipation require that we really know the world in which certain things can happen. But with responsible research and innovation, the hope or the expectation is that we can anticipate the whole world in which things may or may not become possible. And I would argue this is an almost insurmountable challenge. So when we want to talk about anticipation, we should talk about, you know, what can we anticipate? What about the world can we take into view here? Should we really focus more on the kinds of patterns and mechanisms that we are familiar with, and not claim to kind of jump ahead outside of our current world into some imagined future world? Often when people talk about new technologies, what they're saying is, well, we have something in the lab here, and maybe in 20 years' time, we will be able to control all kinds of devices just by merely thinking about them. And let's see what that might mean, and how do we then reform our laws, and so forth and so on. And it, I think, distracts us from the real problems and the real patterns that are going on.
So how can we refocus on the real patterns?
There's this enormous fascination with the future of mobility, the future of the human being, the future of work. We have exhibits, we have museums that take us into these spaces, which are a bit disorienting sometimes, because we don't really know when we go into these spaces. Are we talking about something that's going to happen tomorrow? Are we going to be, is this something that will never happen, right? It's just a space of possibility, which is fascinating and something to speculate about and to philosophize about, but doesn't have traction. But instead, we might be talking about, you know, the challenges of global warming, the challenges of the population issue, resource issues. I mean, there's so many challenges out there.
What are instruments or tools how we can deal with this complexity of technological progress, of societal change, of environmental challenges? This has to integrate very different disciplines and also very different dimensions. What kind of tools could help us?
I sometimes call it the forensics of wishing. I mean, we have a wish for a better world. We have a wish for this kind of technology or that kind of technology. In our research grant proposals, we write that, you know, if this gets funded, you know, these and these benefits will come. All of these are programs, visions, ideas of what we want to bring about. And I think just to reflect on, you know, is this really what we want, right?
Assessing future impacts has two elements, natural science-based prediction with more or less likeliness, and society-based valuation, what is desirable or not. How can methods combine both aspects?
Prediction and evaluation, it's hard to combine them except in the very short term. And obviously, when we have a technology and when we have classical technology assessment and we see what effects a technology has, right, then of course we can maybe extrapolate again just by scientific methods, and then also bring in a societal judgment as to what we like or don't like. For the long term, we want to look at technology and technological development not from the point of view of something that just evolves and that just somehow comes upon us and that we have to react to and maybe modulate or maybe regulate, but that we ask right from the beginning, what kind of technological development do we want and do we need?
So it's basically a question on prioritization and agenda setting on societal level, right?
What we need is a kind of attention to the futures that are in our sort of horizon of expectation. I mean, we have a desire for a future in some ways. We have a desire for a better world, but to make it a desire for a better world means to give it a language that is not just a language of technology and problem solving, right? It's also a language of how to change the world for the better. So this is what I mean by reclaiming the space of politics.
To reclaim the sphere of politics also means to give markets and technologies a different role. Because nowadays we rely on markets and technologies. And the sphere of policy is basically regulation. But is the sphere of policy also the level of discourse, of societal discourse?
In some spaces, it is actually happening in very nice ways. I mean, I think I'm not talking about something that's perfectly illusory. But now we live in the age of climate change, declining biodiversity. We create these strategies of new forms of urban living with urban gardening and guerrilla gardening and whatever you want, the edible city. All these claims, all these models, perhaps, of how also individual citizens, smaller citizens group can bandy together. We have emerging a very big culture. Sort of maker spaces, the maker scene, maker culture. If ordinary citizens start thinking about what can we do to improve our own lives, you know, even as we just play and tinker, we will find ways to come up with maybe low-tech, sustainable solutions, alternatives to some other big infrastructural technologies and so on.
Is there any way how we can bring the large players, multinational corporations, the business sector into this policy sphere, into this debate?
I think on some level they are coming into this, in part because they are also seeing their business future in these kinds of markets and in the ideas that are produced. In the kind of scene I was just describing about urban gardening or the makerspaces, its prototype, after all, is the hacker scene. And we know how closely the hacker community is in some sense connected, almost colluding or being appropriated or dialoguing also with the big names, the big companies.
What skills, what resources, what governance mechanisms do we need to reestablish the policy sphere?
What I would like to see is that there is more sort of attention to detail and more of this back and forth of observation and learning, a kind of social learning process. Many people talk about design, and they talk about design thinking, and they talk about how all of us are happily together as one big community of designers, because no matter whether you're just a consumer who buys something or whether you're a tinkerer or whether we are all together in the business of somehow making the future. And I think it's so unspecific. And there has been another concept of thinking about the way in which we invent the future. It's not the design metaphor, but using the talk of experimentation to say any kind of innovation, whether it comes from a small tinkering lab or whether it comes from a big company, is a bit like an experiment in the real world. You know, society has become a laboratory. It's a much more kind of, let's say, vigilant or careful or critical attitude that we will have towards technologies if we think they are experiments. Let's observe them. Let's see what we can learn from these experiments. Let's see how we can maybe draw some kind of lessons. Maybe we can also stop the experiment.
What kind of level of participation would be the appropriate one? Yeah. Because co-designing the way we live with 100 millions of people, how could we organize this?
Yeah. No one will plan out the perfect technological solution and then it will happen and everyone will like it, right? It's just always going to be a kind of muddling through forces of adaptation and selection, right? We should just acknowledge that it is a process where consumers and producers and politicians all have to work together.
How can we co-design the systems in which we live?
If you talk about responsible research and innovation, we need to talk about how the innovation system as such is conceived and set up. It's not just evolution or development of technology that's just sort of coming and we have to respond to it, but we have to set the selection parameters, so to speak, right? If you talk about evolution, then we have to see evolving towards what? What are the beneficial things that will be selected for, right? In other words, this is where European values come in and global challenges come in. One example of designing such an innovation system for me is what we now call the bioeconomy. The bioeconomy is trying to scale something up from a small scale to a very large scale. At the small scale, we have these certificates for fair trade and a kind of social movement which creates its own market, which has its own incentives and its own values written into it. And I think something like the bioeconomy is like scaling this up to the European level and saying all of research and development should be geared towards certain certain social values.
Is IRI a typically European concept? And what are the European values that we have to take care of when we talk about innovation and when we think about this global competition?
In some sense, it is a very European concept, but not because it's limited to Europe in terms of its scope or its validity, but because it is a concept by which Europeans designate their own ways of organizing research and innovation. And it's supposed to be a model of some kind, and it's a way to draw a more international community of producers or countries into this European way of thinking. Technological development will be more successful in the end if it is better integrated into society at large, right? So that it's in no one's benefit to just start innovating and producing products and then creating a market for it, right? You want this to work in some sense in concert. And I think that is a very, very positive European ideal.
Participation is a core element of responsible innovation. How can we involve citizens? How can we create level playing fields where experts, businesses, and citizens interact on an eye level?
One way is clearly now with these ideas of open science and citizen science to involve citizens in this very elementary way by saying, okay, we'll open up the creative process and we want to encourage universities to work with citizen groups. The other way, I think, concerns the so-called participation of the citizen dialogues. And I think there's a real worry or concern that people are invited for dialogues and then it's empty. It's needed to always keep looking for new formats. And one that I'm thinking about is really to make more of a question of judgment. So we have to find a way to come up with judgments about, for example, how are we doing? So I would actually say, even with very emerging technologies like biotechnology, CRISPR-Cas, let's say, genome editing, or with nanotechnology, where, you know, no one really quite knows what's going to come of it, we can still already ask ourselves, how are we actually handling it now? So we can try to come up with judgments about our own ways, our own ability to handle technological change in a kind of self-monitoring.
What kind of skills and qualifications do we need, therefore?
Being, in some sense, prepared for this kind of broadened and diffuse notion of responsibility that we all share. Thinking about certain European values, including the value of peace and peaceful coexistence and what it means to act towards peace. So to, in some sense, organize this sort of general cultural sense that what we do matters, right? So especially on the engineering side, I think we need engineers that really learn to engage and interact with very, very different kinds of publics and not to be too focused on the specifics of a device, let's say, right? But always kind of try to imagine how the device works in a larger setting.
Thank you very much for this very interesting interview.
Thank you.